The reading is taken from Nehemiah, chapters 11 and 12, and can be found in your pew Bibles on page 496. Now the leaders of the people settled in Jerusalem, and the rest of the people cast lots to bring one out of every 10 to live in Jerusalem, the holy city, while the remaining 9 were to stay in their own homes, towns. The people commended all the men who volunteered to live in Jerusalem. These are the provincial leaders who settled in Jerusalem. Now some Israelites, priests, Levites, temple servants, and descendants of Solomon's servants lived in the towns of Judah, each on his own property in the various towns, while other people from both Judah and Benjamin lived in Jerusalem. The narrator then lists the descendants of Judah, the descendants of Benjamin, the priests, the Levites, the gatekeepers, and the rest of the Israelites. We then pick it up again at the beginning of chapter 12, verse 1. These were the priests and Levites who returned with Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and with Jeshua, Sariah, Jeremiah, Ezra, Amariah, Malok, Hattush, Shechaniah, Rahum, Meremoth, Iddo, Genethon, Abijah, Mijamin, Moadiah, Bilgar, Shemaiah, Joarib, Jediah, Salu, Amok, Hilkiah, and Jediah. These were the leaders of the priests and their associates in the days of Jeshua. The Levites were Jeshua, Benui, Kadmiel, Sherebiah, Judah, and also Mattaniah, who together with his associates was in charge of the songs of thanksgiving. Bakbukiah and Uni, their associates, stood opposite them in the services. Jeshua was the father of Joiakim, and Joiakim the father of Eliashib. Eliashib the father of Joiada, Joiada the father of Jonathan, and Jonathan the father of Jaddua. The narrator then lists the heads of the priestly families and the family heads of the Levites from verses 12 to 26, and we pick that up again from verse 27. At the dedication of the wall of Jerusalem, the Levites were sought out from where they lived and were brought to Jerusalem to celebrate joyfully the dedication with songs of thanksgiving and with the music of cymbals, harps, and lyres. The singers also were brought together from the region around Jerusalem, from the villages of the Netophathites, from Beth Gilgal, and from the area of Geba and Azmaveth, for the singers had built villages for themselves around Jerusalem. When the priests and Levites had purified themselves ceremonially, they purified the people, the gates, and the wall. I had the leaders of Judah go up on top of the wall. I also assigned 2 large choirs to give thanks. One was to proceed on top of the wall to the right, toward the Dung Gate. Hoshea and half the leaders of Judah followed them, along with Azariah, Ezra, Meshulam, Judah, Benjamin, Shemaiah, Jeremiah, as well as some priests with trumpets, and also Zechariah, son of Jonathan, the son of Shemaiah, the son of Mattaniah, the son of Micaiah, the son of Zachar, the son of Asaph, and his associates, Shemaiah, Azarel, Milalai, Gilalai, Maai, Nathanael, Judah, and Hanani, with musical instruments prescribed by David, the man of God. Ezra the scribe led the procession. At the fountain gate, they continued directly up to the steps of the city of David on the ascent to the wall and passed above the house of David to the water gate on the east. The second choir proceeded in the opposite direction. I followed them on top of the wall together with half of the people, past the tower of the ovens to the broad wall, over the gate of Ephraim, the Jeshanah gate, the fish gate, the Tower of Hananel and the Tower of the Hundred as far as the Sheep Gate. At the gate of the God, they stopped. The two choirs that gave thanks then took their places in the house of God. So did I, together with half the officials, as well as the priests, Eliakim, Messiah, Miniamin, Micaiah, Elioenai, Zechariah, and Hananiah, with their trumpets, and also Messiah, Shemaiah, Eleazar, Uzi, Jehonanan, Malkijah, Elam, and Ezer. The choir sang under the direction of Jezrahiah, and on that day they offered great sacrifices, rejoicing because God had given them great joy. The women and children also rejoiced. The sound of rejoicing in Jerusalem could be heard far away.
Annabelle, thank you for reading. Morning, everyone. Great to be with you. My name is Matt. I'm part of the team here. And let me just say, if you're a visitor here this morning and perhaps you're wondering what on earth is going on in this passage, what is with all those names, don't worry, that is exactly what everyone else is thinking as well. But if you're a regular here, you'll know that week by week we open up the Bible, we listen to what God is saying to us, and we want to apply it to our lives. And it's my privilege to lead us as we do that. Our younger youth are just heading out for their own Bible teaching. As they do that, I'm going to pray as we come to God's word. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, we thank you for your living word. We thank you that you are the God who speaks. And we ask now that whether we're familiar with Christian things or whether this is all very new to us, perhaps a little bit strange, that for each one of us, you'd be at work by your Holy Spirit to open our hearts, to open our eyes, to see what is happening here. And we pray, Father, that we might see more of what you have done for us in the Lord Jesus Christ, that as we go from here, we might go with hearts that want to worship him. So help us now, we pray, as we come to your word, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I have to confess, this probably won't surprise you, that sitting in my study this week, reading these chapters with all the names, I didn't feel very inspired. What do you do as a preacher with a passage like this? And I found myself thinking, maybe we should just skip this bit and go straight to chapter 13. There's quite a lot to talk about in chapter 13. The thing is, spoiler alert next week, it doesn't end well in chapter 13. So if we think, oh, there's not really much to look at this morning, we'll miss out on something here that is really rather wonderful. Because this is a real high point in the story of God's people under the leadership of Nehemiah. Last week in chapter 10, God's people committed once again to keep the law of Moses. Way back in Deuteronomy, Moses tells the people of Israel that the sign of true repentance, heart and soul repentance, will be their obedience to God's commands. And so in chapter 10, the people signed their names on the clipboard. Remember the clipboard from last week? Well, the people signed their names, as it were. They committed corporately together to live in obedience to the word of God. So they made a family commitment to raise their children in the faith, not to marry unbelievers. They made a faith commitment to rest from their work, to observe the Sabbath, to trust God, to provide. And they made a financial commitment to pay the temple tax, to contribute from their first fruits for the ministry of the temple. And they summed it up at the end of chapter 10. Just have a look at the end of chapter 10, verse 39, when they said together as one, "We will not neglect the house of our God." So at this point, if you like, the covenant has been signed and sealed. The question is, will it be delivered? Will the people of God follow through in their life together? And in what follows here in chapter 11 and chapter 12, we're given this wonderful picture of what it looks like when the people of God come together in worship. And in amongst the lists of names, we see a community united in worship, singing God's praise, and serving together. And we see what it looks like when God's people are flourishing. And the first thing we see is this: God's kingdom asks for willing servants. Just look with me at verse 1. Now the leaders of the people settled in Jerusalem, and the rest of the people cast lots to bring one out of every 10 to live in Jerusalem, the holy city, while the remaining 9 were to stay in their own towns. The people commended all the men who volunteered to live in Jerusalem. Now, chapter 11 here is picking up the story from back in chapter 7. Go back to chapter 7, and there's some unfinished business. We're told in chapter 7, verse 4, that the city was large and spacious, but there were few people in it. St. Augustine, the bishop of Hippo, once said that cities consist of men, not walls. After the pandemic, what does London need in order to really thrive again? People. It needs workers to return to the office. It needs people who moved out during the lockdown for a bit more space to move back in. It's the people, isn't it, that make the city. Well, here in Nehemiah, Jerusalem at this point is underpopulated. It's not enough for the leaders to settle in Jerusalem. The city needs people who are willing to serve. And although the walls have been rebuilt, remember, Jerusalem is still pretty run down. I mean, basically, nobody really wants to live there. You know, the schools, the hospitals, the transport links, the public services, none of that is back on its feet yet. There's not much to offer, really. And the families who return, some of them chosen by lot, some who volunteered, they are real people. People just like us, with hopes and fears, people with anxieties about the future, you know, concern for their children's education, worried about the air quality for their health, all of those sorts of things. But they go, they move back in, because for the city of God to flourish, the people of God must commit. Now, the long list here in chapter 11 is not actually a list of those who moved back to live in the city, but rather it's a more complete list of God's people from across the generations. It's given, isn't it, in order of tribes and clans, priests, Levites, other officials, and then the people in the villages outside Jerusalem from the tribes of Judah and Benjamin. And we want to take them seriously because these names, they've been written down in the Word of God. We're going to meet these people one day. You know, and they'll be able to say to us, yeah, I had the privilege of being written down in the Word of God so that you could skip it when you read it out loud. And we need to know it was that important. Now, not everyone could squeeze into Jerusalem physically. That's why only 1 in 10 moves in. The rest move into the settlements nearby. The important point is that there's no hierarchy. It's not that the spiritual elite moved back in and everyone else had to commute. No, everyone has a part to play. And we get a flavor of that just from a very quick glance at the text. So the able men, we see them in verse 6, verse 8, verse 14. The NIV doesn't have it in verse 8, but it's there. They are literally men of valor, valiant men, fighting men, whose job presumably was to defend the city against an attack. They were needed for Jerusalem to flourish. In verse 12 and verse 16, there are the men who did the work of the temple inside and outside. In verse 17, there's the director who led in thanksgiving and prayer alongside the singers and the musicians in verse 22, verse 23. Then there's Pethahiah in verse 24, who oversaw the royal court on behalf of the king. What does all this tell us? Basically, from the boardroom, if you like, down to the shop floor, there is order and organization. And at long last, the people of God are where they should be. And in spite of all the opposition, in spite of the sinfulness and the failings of his people, God has kept his promise. And he has restored his people to the land, to the city, and to the temple. Now, in our context today, the church is the new Jerusalem. And as God's people today, we are called to represent God's glory to the world around us. And that's why Jesus says to his disciples in Matthew 5, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden." And so God is calling us to commit to his church. And of course, our eyes glaze over at a long list of names, but these names fit into a story. The story of what God is doing in the world to save sinners like us for eternity. And it is a precious thing to be a part of that story, to belong to his people. Talking of willing servants, it was Jesus, of course, Philippians 2, who took on the very nature of a servant and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And it's through his death that we can be written into God's story. You just have to accept that Christ died for your sins and he rose again for your forgiveness. Can I ask you this morning, did you know, do you know that you can have a place in God's story? You just have to turn to him as a willing servant in repentance and faith. God's kingdom asks for willing servants. Then second, God's kingdom is built on faithful leadership. Having populated the city, God can only be worshipped, of course, if there are priests there to make the sacrifices and to lead God's people in praise and thanksgiving. So the next thing Nehemiah has to sort out is the ministry team. Let's pick it up just from chapter 12 and verse 1. These were the priests and Levites who returned with Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and with Jeshua. Now the priests and the Levites were from the tribe of Levi, and the priests came from the family of Aaron within that tribe. And the lists that follow in chapter 12 span several generations. So Jeshua was the high priest who returned with Zerubbabel to rebuild the temple. That was before Nehemiah's time. Then verses 1 to 9 list the names of the priests and Levites during Jeshua's term of office. Then verses 10 and 11 introduce us to Jeshua's son and his son and his son, all the way down to Jeshua's great-great-great-grandson, Jaddua. And then from verse 12 to 26, we're given the names of the priests and the leaders of the people during the lifetime of each of these men. Now, what's the point here? Well, very simply, the temple cannot function without the priests. For the people of God to flourish, there needs to be a priesthood that endures from one generation to another, to another, to another, and so on. And we've discovered throughout the book that there's quite a lot to do to bring about renewal in Jerusalem. But here's the thing, that the social agenda, the political structures, the economic reforms, none of those will achieve anything if the spiritual foundations are not in place first. Essentially, Nehemiah is overseeing the renewal of an entire nation from top to bottom. And to do that, he knows he needs to provide first for the spiritual health of the people. And that means building a ministry team of priests and leaders who will minister God's word, who will offer sacrifices on behalf of the people, who will lead them in praise and thanksgiving. Without that, the economy, the educational system, the transport links, all the, forget it, it makes no difference. There has to be a healthy spiritual foundation. And we need the same faithful leadership today in our churches. Not just in terms of paid staff and ordained ministers, but in our ministries more generally. If you think of it in terms of some of the sort of roles and structures we have here, I guess you could say on the PCC, in our growth groups, for those who teach our children and our teenagers. In fact, in all our ministries, we need men and women who are committed to passing on the gospel to the next generation. We need leaders who will refuse to conform to the pattern of this world. Ministers who will resist the temptation to tell people what their itching ears want to hear. And by the way, it's really tempting to tell people what they want to hear. We need ministers who instead will teach the truth and contend for the faith. And today, of course, is Mothering Sunday. Do you notice that the lists here in these chapters, that they're given in terms of the family names? It's a reminder that from one generation to another, it's actually a theme you can trace through Nehemiah, God works through families. His kingdom grows. It was happening here in chapter 12 as they moved back into the city. As a mother makes the spiritual health of her children her number one priority. Above grades and success and career. It grows as dads open the Bible with their children at the kitchen table. It grows as children grow up to hear their parents praying together at home, and they grow to understand that's normal. His kingdom grows as grandparents pray for their children, take every opportunity to encourage them in the faith. Later on, we'll share bread and wine together. And even when our children aren't taking communion, they'll be watching as the rest of us do. And they'll glimpse in the bread and the wine those visible signs of grace, a visible expression of the gospel. They'll watch as we come together from different backgrounds with different stories, and they'll glimpse at the Lord's table a unity that is only possible through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's a precious thing for them to see. How do we ensure that our, if you're a Christian here today, how do we ensure that our personal experience of redemption is passed on to the next generation? Through faithful leadership in the family at home and in the family of God's people in the church. God's kingdom grows through faithful leadership. Then finally, God's kingdom is known for joyful celebration. Now, the wall, of course, you'll remember, was completed back in chapter 7, but it hasn't yet been dedicated because God wanted to kind of work first, as it were, on his people. But now they've settled in their towns. The tenth of them have moved back into the city. They've heard the reading of the law. They've confessed their sins. They've renewed their covenant with the Lord. And so finally, the celebrations can begin. Read with me from verse 27. At the dedication of the wall of Jerusalem, the Levites were sought out from where they lived and were brought to Jerusalem to celebrate joyfully the dedication with songs of thanksgiving and with the music of cymbals, harps, and lyres. So they gather the best group of musicians they can find from right across the region. They basically pull together the best choir, the best band that they can manage. No doubt there's Nehemiah's probably pushed a bit for a little bit extra in the budget for the sort of sound and the tech and maybe some dry ice or something. Josh would think that all his birthdays have come at once, basically. They go big. And it's a wonderful glimpse, this, I think, of what's possible, of what it's like when God's people, all of them, come together in worship. Everyone present, everyone involved. You know, the people doing the sound, playing their part, the coffee team, people putting out the chairs, people staying afterwards to welcome newcomers, to pray for people, people washing up perhaps after the bring and share lunch. And as they do that, they're sharing stories together of how God has been at work. Maybe they're reminiscing as they put the kit away at the end of the day about, do you remember the rebuilding of the dung gate? Oh, I'm glad I wasn't involved. Oh, the stench of, apparently, yeah, well, the Smiths had to do it. I mean, whoa. But they'll laugh and they'll celebrate how God was at work. Maybe they'll remember that night. Do you remember that night when the men had to go out and defend the wall and the women and children stayed at home and prayed and God heard our prayers and he answered them and the attack was repelled? God has been so good to us, hasn't he? The storytelling, the remembering, so important in the life of a community. It's a picture, this here, of a Jerusalem that is becoming once more the city of God, not just in geographical terms, but in terms of her people, in terms of the spiritual health of the city. They really are the city on the hill, a community displaying the glory of the Lord to the surrounding nations. And they are going to make as much noise as they can. So what happens? Well, when everyone's assembled, Nehemiah sends up two huge choirs onto the wall, one to the south, one to the north. The leaders and the people then follow them up, one half on each side. And just picture, it must have been an incredibly moving moment. There they are standing on this wall, surrounding the city. And this is the wall they've repaired with their very own hands. You know, you can spot the bit that the proper tradesmen have done, like Graham Greene, because it's been done properly. And then you can spot the bit where people like Matt Beebe were involved, who are useless at DIY because it looks a bit wonky. But it doesn't matter because the mood is celebration. So we're just thrilled that we've managed to rebuild this between us. You can imagine that. And the whole city is surrounded with singing. Verse 43 sums it up. Just read verse 43 with me. And on that day they offered great sacrifices, rejoicing because God had given them great joy. The women and children also rejoiced. It was a family occasion. The sound of rejoicing in Jerusalem could be heard far away. You'll discover when we get to chapter 13 next week that this would be a really good place to end the book. This is where Netflix would end it. You know, the uplifting soundtrack, you know, the camera panning back. Because reconciliation between God and his people is always something to celebrate. Every time a sinner comes home, there is a party in heaven, there is a feast. And we should celebrate here as well on earth. And our celebration should be so loud that the story of what the Lord has done in our lives can be heard even by those who are far away. Something I've discovered living in Gerrard's Cross is that people enjoy a good party. Occasionally, it's usually in the summer, you know, those sort of long summer evenings. There's a party somewhere nearby that goes into the early hours. And although it's dark and, you know, you can't see anything, on a sort of still summer's evening, the sound travels. I'm quite a light sleeper, so lying in bed at night, I can hear the party. And as you hear the sounds kind of rolling across the night sky, you start to kind of wonder, you know, you can hear the dance floor or the band, people talking or laughing, and you start to sort of wonder, I wonder what's the occasion? Wedding? 50th birthday party? 21st? Not sure. And the thing that you're looking for is the genre of the music. You know, which decade does the DJ go for, sort of thing. Occasionally he mixes it up. That's quite confusing. Maybe it's a wedding spanning the generations. I don't know. But it's so loud that I can't help but wonder, who's it for? Who's there? What's the occasion? And I'm drawn into it. I just can't help it. I'm drawn into it. We want to be a church that is known for our joy in the Lord. We want to be a church that is known for celebrating what God has done in our lives. That as we celebrate and tell the story, even those who are far away can hear the celebrations and they're drawn to them. And we want to be praying that they'll be drawn to hear the story of the gospel, to see what God has done in our lives through Jesus, that they might experience that thing for themselves as well. So we want to make sure that we celebrate what God is doing amongst us as a church family. I think through the sort of desert of lockdown, we've kind of lost the art of celebration. We're rediscovering it, I think, as we go. You see, living off our memories of the past, you know, that moment maybe when the gospel first became real to you, or a particular spiritual high that you wish you could repeat, but it was many years ago now, that will not be enough to sustain you. So we need to make a point of remembering and celebrating what God has done for us so that it's just built into the rhythm of our lives. And of course, we do that every week as we gather on a Sunday. We're doing it now. We do it every month as we gather to pray at Prayer Central. Then within the church calendar, there are particular seasons, aren't they? There are particular occasions. There are the festivals of Christmas and Easter. There are the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper. So there are things that are given to us. And then there are little traditions that we establish of our own, as any church does. Our vision dinners in September. Our review of the year as we pray together in July at Prayer Central. Or our weekend away coming up again next year. Lots of other things. Now, some of those will feel like a mountaintop experience. Big effort, big energy, big budget. Some of them will feel much more ordinary. But all of them are about God's people coming together to celebrate his goodness and to sing his praise. The Apostle Peter in 1 Peter 2 says, "You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God." Why? "That you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into this wonderful light." We want to enjoy what God is doing amongst us, and we want to express that joy in praise that will be heard far away. God's kingdom is known for joyful celebration. So there we are, willing servants, faithful leadership, joyful celebration. Three things, if you like, that signify the flourishing of God's people. Three marks, they're not the only ones, but three marks of a healthy church. And I just want to encourage us this morning to give thanks for the way God is at work here at St. James. And we can't expect a mountaintop experience every week. We're not encouraged to go looking for one. Humanly speaking, a lot of the transformation that takes place is really rather ordinary. As we trust God, as we listen to his word, as we keep going week by week in the trials of life. But as the Holy Spirit does his work, something extraordinary is taking place. And as God's people, we are being renewed. And I just want to encourage us this morning to see that, to rejoice in it. If you're new here, or maybe just sort of dipping a toe back in the water, coming back to church life, I want to say, come and taste a bit more of it. Come and discover, rediscover what God is doing in people's lives. One of my many weaknesses is that I'm a perfectionist. And it's easy to think it's good. It means you've got high standards. It's not. It's a miserable affliction because it means you're never quite satisfied and you never quite feel you're doing enough and there's always more you could be doing. So I have found this passage a real tonic for my soul this week, because it has prompted me just to step back and to remember to celebrate, to enjoy, to rejoice in what God is doing. It's been a tonic for me. I want to pray it'll be a tonic for you as well. Allow it to speak to you in the same way today. Let's pray. The sound of rejoicing in Jerusalem could be heard far away. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful glimpse here this morning of your kingdom being renewed in Jerusalem under Nehemiah, of the people gathering as one to give you thanks and praise. We thank you for the great joy that we have of being caught up in that story as we trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, as we look at what you are doing in our lives. And we want to pray, Father, that we might increasingly be a people known for our joy. We want to pray, Father, we'd be those who celebrate. And so we give you thanks for all that you have done for us in Jesus Christ. We thank you for the great privilege of being written into your story of redemption. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.